If you want to learn how to animate characters, stick around and I'll show you how. I'm using a pixel art character made in Aseprite, but these tips should apply to all mediums and animation software. So this is Lumber, a wood gathering dwarf. He needs to chop this wood and take it back to his village, but currently he's just standing still. So let's animate him. Step one, reference. You can usually find reference of the action you're trying to animate online, but you can get bonus points if you film yourself acting it out. This will help you understand vital information like key poses and timing. Timing is one of the 12 principles of animation, some very simple guidelines I try and follow with everything I animate. If you don't know what the 12 principles of animation are, make sure you let me know in the comments and subscribe, and I'll make a video about it in the future. Step 2, break down the character into parts.
Yes. Tear the character limb from limb.
Oh, made me feel sick that actually. Separating the character into parts can help you focus on one thing at a time and get more accurate animation. Step 3, the key poses. I learned from taking a reference video that the key poses are in the anticipation and follow through. So I'm gonna draw the dwarf. That's hard to say. So I'm going to draw the dwarf in these poses, making sure to exaggerate them to match the style that I'm going for. Quick tip, smear frames. I want to show the axe flying through the air in between these two keyframes, but instead of placing the axe in every single frame between, I like to use a single arced smear frame. This is where the axe is stretched from the start to the end position and occurs as one big image like this. Smear frames are common in cartoons and often look really silly on their own, but they're great for getting across quick motions. Step 4, timing. With only 3 frames, we have a basic chopping animation, but it still kind of looks off. Currently, each frame is on screen for the same amount of time, and timing is really important. I just spat all over the mic there, very nice. A slower build-up and follow-through will give the impression that there is some weight to the axe. Simply changing the duration of each frame can help us make more believable motion. I drew in a couple more frames to the anticipation and follow through to give it that slow in and out, and that really gets the timing across well. Remember that timing also depends on the character. A large, strong character might not have a problem picking up an axe, but swinging it through the air might be a bit slower and sluggish. Thinking about the context of your animation will help make it more believable. Step 5, overlap or secondary animation. I've already done a little bit of this. If you look at the animation, we can see the hair and the beard moving somewhat independently from the rest of the body. But I like the idea that the dwarf's facial features will squash and stretch as he's flying about chopping the axe. Adding that in, we now have a dynamic chopping animation. To recap this process, we filmed some reference for our action, acting it out to make sure we understood the key parts. We broke down the character into parts for easier animation. We drew the character into the key poses, exaggerating with a squash and stretch and using a smear frame for our quick chopping motion. We adjusted the timing of the action to make it more believable, changing the duration of the frames and adding in extra frames for that slow in and out. Finally, we added some overlapping and secondary actions. I applied that same process and made this little idle animation too. Now he's no longer standing like a robot, but he can't walk, so he's never going to be able to take that wood back to his village.
I, the pixel necromancer, have the true power.
5,000 likes and I'll make him walk. It's now up to you to save Lumber.
Bonus round.
What's up? In the last pixel art video, we designed this frog character. If you don't know what I'm talking about, then go and check out that video. That'll show you how I design characters in pixel art. In that video, I took you through the whole process of designing the character, so I thought it would be nice now to take you through the process of animating the character, since this is an animation video. So we're doing it live, kind of. It's edited. It's gonna be edited by me. Now, step one, I did say was the reference, but that I know what I want him to do, and it's this, which is exactly why acting it out is mega important. So if you can act it out yourself, you'll know exactly what you want the frog to do. Right, so step two. I can't remember what the steps were. God, I wrote the steps. Break down the character into parts. This character is really good for practicing animation because it's really just a circle, you know, super basic, no complex parts. We don't have to break it up into different limbs, things like that. We can just imagine he's a big blob of goo, which he is, big froggy goo boy. So let's animate him. I was going to do an idle, but I think we'll just do a simple hop. So if we're not taking any reference, because that's the reference, and I'm not breaking it down into body parts because it's so simple, now it's time to put it into the key poses. So let's do it. I'm going to start off in this pose, but the first key pose that I'm going to put him into is the anticipation frame. Swinging a bat's a good example. If you're going to swing a bat, you don't just swing it from the starting position. You would wind up and then swing the bat. So it's essentially the wind-up frame. So what I'm doing here when I'm trying to put him in this anticipation phase is I'm going to squash him out. So imagine he's being pushed down and his entire body is squashing and elongating outwards. Down like that, and then he'll pop up and spring into the air. They do say try and keep the volume the same. If I was to make him that big, then it's kind of unbelievable because he was only that big to start off with. Nice little trick you can do is just focus on one side and then mirror it so you don't have to do more work. So we're getting the basics of the squash in here, but the volume isn't looking quite right. It looks like it's actually expanding a bit. So I'm just going to keep working on this until I get the squash right. This does take time. You know, you won't get it perfect first time. So animation is a long, lengthy process, but it's fun. So let's keep going. So that's a nice start for the anticipation frame. That's just one frame. Could probably be improved, but we'll just keep going. Okay, I'll use that for the anticipation frame. Next frame that I need to do is needs to be in the air. So let's add a new frame. I'm going to take the basic frog again because he's not going to be squashed while he's in the air. And let's just move him there. Let's say there. That's a basic hopping animation. It's not great. You know, there is no real follow through there, but it's the basics. We're getting there. So we've got a first frame. He'll squash down into that, which I want to be more stretched out, I think. So I'm going to stretch this out. If his volume is stretching long ways, it needs to also shrink inwards. Otherwise, the volume of the character is going to be wrong. So let's just move him in. We could probably just move him in a couple of times. Try and keep it exaggerated. His legs, obviously, if he's hopping through the air, they're not going to be curled up anymore either. So keep that in mind. We have a basic hop there, nothing too special. Let's slow that down so we can really see. What I notice here immediately when I'm looking at this, it doesn't have a peak of the jump. So you'd imagine when he reaches the peak of the jump that he'd actually slow down as well. So he'd probably squash up again to normal size, and then he'd come back down, and then a little bit of a follow through. So let's keep working. Let's try just adding another frame here. Copy the basic proportion of the frog, but move him up. So you see how he reaches the top of his jump there and he squashes back into normal proportions. Let's play that at one time speed. He's getting there. That's looking a bit better there, where he slows down at the top of the peak, goes back into normal proportions. And now we need him to come back down again. I think it would be nice to do a smear there. Let's try that. This frame needs to go in between these two frames. But just putting it there probably won't look that good. Let's have a look. I mean, it's all right. It's not bad. But I think it would be nicer to have it smear as if there's some downwards motion in there. This is pretty easy. I can just move him up, move him down, spread him out. When you're doing a smear frame, I sort of imagine like spreading jam on bread or something on toast. It goes from one end to the other. You spread it and it leaves that trail behind it. And that's what you're trying to do with the frog. So I want his entire eyes to sort of come down, just stretch him out. And this might not work. This smear might not work for this motion. It might be too fast. It might look too quick, but a lot of animation is just trying it out. And if nothing else comes of it, at least we got to see this guy. I think that's the greatest frog I've ever drawn. That's it, friends. Pack it up. Let's have a look at this smear so far. There, so you see how his eyes sort of stretch down. I don't really like the smile of it. I think we could probably get away with hiding the smile. Okay, that's kind of good. Anticipation flies into the air, reaches his max, comes back down, and then there he is. I can just see here there are some parts which need fleshing out a bit more with timing. The top of his jump, he goes back into his normal proportions, but I actually want to squash him up again just to extend this even further to really make it come across as if he's like floating into the air. And we could just try starting off with the squash down here. And let's put it in that place, but also move it upwards. You see what I mean? Where he just sort of hangs in the air a little bit more there. Timing's still a bit off. We still got some things to work on, so let's keep going. Okay, so what I want to do is actually change this landing, because it really feels off now that it just stops stiff and lands. So again, another squash frame might be nice here. Could just replace this landing one with the squash. That's him sort of going right through the bottom pose and then popping back into the standard pose. So let's see what that looks like. Pretty good. I kind of want him to land first, so let's try adding this frame in and adding the proper proportioned frog in before the squash. The timing's definitely very off, so I'm just going to mess around with the timing of each frame here and see if I can make something really nice, make the timing work a little bit better without adding any more frames. So let's add frame properties. So every frame here is in 100 milliseconds or 0.1 seconds. We can change the duration of things. So let's give it a shot just to see what it would feel nicer as. So the squashing down, I want that to be on for, let's say, 200. So that's going to elongate the squashing down. And that's already looking a bit better. But this bit here at the top, I want to do the same here. So let's make this 200, because then it's really slowing down the motion. That's very nice, much better. That's pretty good, I think. We're getting there, a nice little hop animation. I think it'd be nice to add another frame in here where he goes back to normal proportions before he squashes down, and that's gonna elongate that top section bit as well. That's it, yes, that's looking a lot better. Let's play that here so you guys can see. That's looking a lot better. He really hangs about at the top there, which is what I prefer. And that's looking pretty good. I'm gonna just add in another frame here in the anticipation. So we've got one squash down. Let's add even more of a squash down. You're looking thick. That's pretty good. I kind of like it though. It's like blum, 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 blum. Feel free to do your own sound effects. For a basic animation of the frog, think that's pretty good. Our little hopping frog. So just to break down what I did for this, so we had the squash down and then the flying pose, and then he would just return straight back to his normal pose. But then what we did is we wanted the top of the jump to be even longer, so we added in some more frames at the top, which is this bit here and then this bit here, where he really reaches the top of his jump and his backhand catches up with him. And then he falls back down again with the smear animation into his normal pose, squashes down for some follow through. When he hits the ground, he'll follow through and then he'll come back up into the normal position, which is there. So there you go. Boing, boing, boing. It's not perfect. It could use a lot more work with the timing and playing around with the volumes of the pixels, but it's good enough for this demonstration. Hope you enjoyed. And there it is, my process for animating characters. I hope you like it. Let me know what you think in the comments. Make sure you come and join the Discord channel. More and more people are joining, which is super cool. Everyone can share the projects that they're working on, give some feedback, and help each other improve. As always, chop that subscribe button. Chop. Get it, because the wood and the dwarf and the animation is the and all of the links for the social media will be in the description, so make sure you come and say hello. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Right, now I gotta edit this shit.